Good morning, everybody. Today we'll be starting the second session on the chapter 1, that is mechatronic sensors and transducers. So today we'll be talking about the performance terminologies or some of the definitions which are used in this chapters or mechatronics subject. So firstly, let us take the range. The range of a sensor indicates the limits between which the input can vary. That is, for example, let us take a thermocouple. So it can have an operating range of say 25 to 225 degrees centigrade. So in between these two values, it can generate any value. Okay. Next, let me talk about the span. Span is nothing but the difference between the maximum and minimum values of the input. As we discussed earlier, in the range, we had a range of around 25 to 225. So the maximum value was 225 and the minimum value was 25. So if you take the difference of 225 and 25, it would be around 200 degrees centigrade. So the span of this instrument is now 200 degrees centigrade. So let me come to the third terminology, that is error. So error is nothing but the difference between the result of measurement and the true value. That is, it had to be a particular value, but it is some other value. So that difference we'll call it as the error. Okay. So there is an example over there. A sensor might give a displacement reading of 29.8 mm when the actual displacement had to be 30 mm. So it had to be 30, but it is showing 29.8. So the error, suppose we minus 30 with 29.8, we will get the error as minus 0.2 mm. Okay. Next, the terminology, we'll move on to the next terminology, accuracy. Accuracy defines the closeness of agreement between the actual measurement result and the true value of the measurand. So it is being expressed in terms of full range. Next, coming to the sensitivity. Sensitivity is defined as the ratio of change in output of a sensor to the unit change in input of that particular sensor. So next terminology I will define is nonlinearity. So the graph, in the graph you can observe that there are two curves. One is the ideal curve and one more is the measured curve. Okay. So the ideal curve is a straight line, whereas the measured curve is a curve. So the nonlinearity indicates the maximum deviation of the actual measured curve of a sensor from the ideal curve. So in the figure you can see the maximum error being displayed in between the measured curve and the ideal curve. So that gives the nonlinearity error. So next terminology is the hysteresis. As you can see from the graph, that we'll call it as the hysteresis error curve. So transducers can give different outputs for the same value of quantity that is being measured. So this output is continuously changing, either increasingly or is it continuously decreasing change. So that effect is called as the hysteresis error effect, and the error is called as the hysteresis error. Next, resolution. Resolution is nothing but the smallest change in the input value that will produce a change in the output value which is observable. So smallest change in the input which will produce an observable change in the output is called as the resolution. Next, we have stability. Stability is nothing but which will give the same output when it is used to measure a constant input over a period of time. But over a period of time is important. So it should be stable enough. That is, it should give the same output. How many times ever you repeat the input being measured, it should give the same output for a particular period of time. The term drift is also there. Drift is nothing but which is used to indicate the change in output that occurs over a period of time. It may be due to different reasons. The output can be deferred. Next, coming to the dead time. So the dead time is the range of input values for which there will be no output. Suppose imagine there is a small change that has occurred in the input, but the output is not being displayed still. So that gap is known as the dead band or the dead time, wherein there is no output, even though there is an input given, but the output may occur after few seconds or milliseconds. So that time we will call it as the dead time. Next, coming to the repeatability. Repeatability is nothing but ability of sensor to give the same output for repeated applications of the same input. That is, whenever you give the same input, the same output should occur how many more times we try to measure it. So coming to the last terminology, that is the response time, it describes the speed of change in the output on a stepwise change of the measurement. So next, coming to the classification of transducers, we have two types of transducers, analog and digital transducers. So again, in analog we have different kinds of transducers like piezoelectric, capacitive, inductive, photoemissive and photoconductive. Whereas in digital transducers we have frequency domain transducers and digital encoders. So these are few classifications of transducers. So basically there are of two types, which are analog and digital, that we need to know. Next, coming to the types of sensors, there are three types of sensors, namely displacement, proximity and position sensors. So displacement sensor, so what is meant by displacement sensor? It is nothing but a sensor which is concerned with the measurement of amount by which the object has been moved. Okay, so displacement means amount by which the object is being moved or displaced. So next, coming to the position sensor. Position is nothing but it is concerned with the determination of position of the object with some reference point. So for this, the example would be a remote control which you use for your TVs. So definitely within a certain, from one reference point, say you are sitting at one position, you press a button, the channel changes. But suppose you move to a farther distance and then again press the same button, but the channel may not change. So it is the position of the object with some reference point, that is the TV at what distance it is from the remote, that is your position sensor. So coming to the third one is the proximity sensor. So proximity sensor is nothing but, it's also a position sensor, but it is used to determine when the object has moved to within some particular distance of the sensor. So best example of this proximity sensor is, say we have, nowadays most of you might have been seen in the cars. So when we come near the car, there is a beep that is being sounded and the car doors open automatically. Also, when the passenger and the driver comes out of the car and he moves to a certain distance, then again there is a beep and the car gets locked. So it is how much that person has moved within that critical distance of the sensor. So there is a sensor being fixed in the car. So how much distance he is from the sensor. So if he crosses that, or if he enters inside that, there is a beep, as a result of which there may be opening or a closing of a locks in the car. Next, coming to factors to be considered for selection of sensors. There are many factors which needs to be considered when we need to select a sensor. For example, let us think of some medical equipments. So, let us take an example of a medical equipment, wherein the cost of sensor is too high, but we need to have good quality of sensors being placed inside that. As a result of which, it should not it should not get it should work for a long time. Also, it should satisfy the purpose for what it is being used. So the cost of sensor may be high, but again it depends on the application. If it's a medical equipment, say for medical equipment like we have critical medical equipments, so the cost of sensors should not be a major concern, but the quality of the sensor should be good. Also, the size of displacement, whether it's a linear displacement or an angular displacement which is happening. Also, the accuracy required of the sensor. Say, if we have to measure the altitude of a aircraft, so we need to have a good accuracy instrument which gives the correct height as to how much height the aircraft is being throttled around. So if there the accuracy is not right, then probably there may be air accidents that happen. So depending on the accuracy or the usage where it's being mounted, so the accuracy is also a concern. It also depends on the types of materials to be sensed. So we have seen sensors in the cars, ignition systems. So if the correct key is inserted, then only the ignition needs to be started. If there is a wrong key, the car should not start. So this is the type of material that needs to be sensed. Whether is it the original key or is it a duplicate key which is being inserted, that should be sensed, as a result of which thefts have been reduced now. Next, coming to the classification of sensors, we have displacement sensors, velocity sensors, force sensor, liquid flow sensors, liquid level sensors, temperature sensor, and light sensors. So today we will not be covering all the sensors, we will be looking into only the displacement sensors. So there are different kinds of displacement sensors, we will move around one by one. So the first one I would like to take of the displacement sensor is the LVDT, that is linear variable differential transformer. So coming to the construction of a LVDT sensor, as you can see in the sketch, there are two secondary coils and one primary coil which is placed inside the insulated tube. A central core is being placed in between the primary and the secondary coils. So it has got three coils which is placed along an insulated tube. So the central coil is the primary coil and the other two are the secondary coils. So this is a simple construction. Next we will move on to the working of a LVDT sensor. As you can see from the first sketch, due to an alternating voltage in the primary coil, that is in the primary coil we have a voltage being generated, so there is an alternating EMF which is generated in the secondary coils. So there is one single primary coil and two secondary coils. When the armature is at the center, the alternating voltage which is passed on to the primary coil generates EMF in the secondary coils. So in the two secondary coils, when the EMF or the voltage are the same, the resultant voltage is zero. So if the core or the armature is moved from one location to either upwards or downwards, then towards which side the core is being moved or the armature is being moved, the EMF generated in that coil will be more. So the maximum to whatever distance the armature moves, that high the EMF will be generated in that particular coil. So you can see the two moments in the second and the third sketch. So armature being moved upwards, secondary coil number one will be having more EMF generated. When it moves downwards, the secondary coil two will have the EMF generated. So with the help of this signal processing devices such as low pass filters and demodulators, precise displacement can be measured by using this LVDT sensors. Coming to the second one, pneumatic sensors. Pneumatic sensors are used to measure the displacement as well as to sense the proximity of the object, that is closeness to where it is. So it has got three ports, say port A and port B. So low pressure air is passed to the port A, as a result of which, in the absence of any obstacle or object, coming to the first sketch, if there is no object in front of the port A or port B, as a result of which this low pressure air escapes from port A and hence reduces the pressure in port B. But however, coming to the second sketch, when an object is being placed in between the near to the port A and port B, so as the low pressure air starts from the port A, there is a rise in output, there is a rise in pressure in the port B. This rise in pressure is calibrated in order to measure the displacement or to trigger any switch. So this kind of sensors are being used in robots in order to detect the if there is any obstacle in front of the robot so that it can reverse back. Also, it is being used for tooling in CNC machines. Coming to the third one, Hall effect sensor. There are two sketches. I will be explaining the first sketch. So the first sketch shows the principle of working of Hall effect sensor. That is, when a beam of charged particles passes through a magnetic field, you can see a magnet at the top and the bottom there is a green line. So when a beam of charged particles passes through this magnetic field, forces act on the particles and the current beam is deflected from the straight path. So it was traveling in a straight path, it has been deflected. Thus on one side of the disc will be negatively charged and the other side will be positively charged. This charge separation generates a potential difference, which is the measure of distance of the magnetic field from the disc carrying current. So coming to the second sketch, the application of a Hall effect sensor being used in order to measure the level of fuel in automobile fuel tank. So as you can see in the second sketch, there is a Hall effect sensor being placed at the top. A magnet is being attached to the float. So as the liquid level changes, the float or the magnet distance between the magnet and the Hall effect Hall sensor will also change. So as the distance changes, it produces a voltage output proportional to the level of liquid in the tank. Coming to the last, proximity switches, which is again a part of the displacement sensors. So figure above shows lever operated. You can see in the sketch there are three kinds of operations of a proximity switch. That is a lever operated switch, roller operated and a cam operated. In a lever operated switch, a button is used to operate the switch. So these are used in the conveyors, or the you might have been seen it in the metro stations, wherein the as a person enters into the metro station and he needs to climb the stairs, the escalator will start upon, as a result of which he stands on the escalator and he moves from a lower distance to a higher distance. So there are different operations like roller operated switch, cam operated switch, as shown in this sketch above. So these are basically they are used to detect the presence of an item on one conveyor belt. It can be used in conveyor systems or it can also be used in your escalators, as I said. So those are the proximity switches. As soon as the person enters the metro station, if he moves closer to the steps or the escalator starts moving. So that is a button operated switch. Also you can see it in the malls, wherein the door automatically opens or the door automatically closes. So when he moves to a certain distance, the door will be closed. So these are the proximity switches, which will the sensors will sense the person which is coming, as a result of which the doors are going to open out. So once the person has entered and moved to a certain distance, the doors are going to close automatically. That is, whatever the distance it is from the, so that distance we'll call it as the proximity switches. We need not switch on or switch off the, it is all done automatically based on sensors. So there are few multiple questions on these slides. So around 13 questions have been framed based on these slides. For this session, you can answer all of this based on these slides. Thank you for your kind cooperation.